I'm very pleased today to discuss results of Parks and Wildlife funded research project on the rough-footed mud turtle. My collaborators and I conducted JAG research on this species throughout its range in Texas and Mexico, and we have some really exciting results to share with you today. So first of all, I would like to share First of all, I'd like to introduce the presenters who will be speaking to you today. I'm Andy Glusenkamp. I'm Director of Conservation in San Antonio Zoo's Center for Conservation and Research. Also joining us is Rodrigo Macip. He is a professor in La Escuela Nacional de Estudios Superiores, Unidad Morelia, and Universidad Nacional Autonomía de México. Jennifer Smith is a professor in the Department of Biology, New Mexico State University, Alamogordo. And Samuel Weaver is a PhD candidate in Ecology, Evolution, and Behavior at the University of Minnesota. So I'm just going to give you a little background information about the species, and then we'll go into a bit about what it was that we were interested in pursuing and what questions we were seeking to answer. The rough-footed mud turtle, Canisterna hirtabes, is listed as threatened in Texas. It's protected in Mexico. That means it's not available for commercial collection, et cetera. It's very similar to the state threatened designation. And it has a NatureServe conservation rank of G5S1. And that's important. I'll get back to that later. Canisterna hirtabes includes six subspecies, most with extremely small geographic ranges. One of these microendemic, the KH megacephalum, is extinct, and three others have experienced precipitous population declines in recent decades. Those are KH chapalensis, KH magdalense, and KH hirtabes. The distribution and taxonomic status of the six subspecies, KH murrayi, is unclear, hence the research. Its range extends from the Transvolcanic Belt in central Mexico to the Big Bend region of Texas, but the taxonomic identity of most populations has not been assessed. And here I'd just like to include a really prescient quote from John Iverson in his 1981 population on I'm sorry, his 1981 publication on Canisterna hirtabes. Iverson said the propensity, perhaps restriction, of members of the K. hirtabes group for permanent water habitats, coupled with the geographical isolation of inhabited river basins due to historical geology and desertification, have produced at least 30 allopatric populations of members of this group. We weren't able to test that in terms of there being 30 allopatric populations, but I think that Iverson back in 1981 really hit the nail on the head. So some of the fundamental questions that we had in embarking on this research were, what are the phylogenetic affinities and taxonomic status of Canisterna hirtabes murrayi, and specifically Texas populations? Also, is there gene flow among Texas and Mexican populations, and how does the genetic status of Texas populations compared to other populations? And finally, what conservation opportunities exist in Texas and Mexico for this species? Two hypotheses, two sort of alternate explanations regarding the status of these northern populations are as follows. One, that Chihuahuan desert populations, that includes Texas and Chihuahuan populations, represent metapopulations or a northern extension of a single widely distributed taxon. Alternatively, these populations may represent one or more evolutionary significant units existing in isolated refugia. So the first one sort of follows the current taxonomic framework that we have a single wide-ranging species that that is widespread throughout Mexico and just has fingers up into Chihuahua and Texas. The second one is sort of getting back to what Iverson said in 1981, that these things are very highly isolated and that there are numerous allopatric populations, especially in these areas that have undergone a lot of desertification during the history of the species. So that was basically the landscape that we were traversing. One component of our work involved actually doing field work, going out into the field in both Texas and Mexico to try and document populations and also collect genetic material for the next phases of the analysis. We had really divergent results. So this slide here, you can see, if you look closely on the left-hand side, actually three turtles in that pool of water right there. And that's exactly as found. So those are three large adults in about two foot of water in a pool in a very small creek in Big Bend Ranch State Park. And here you can see Russell Martin and a couple of volunteers from Sol Ross University checking out a turtle trap that we placed elsewhere along that creek. And then in these images, you can see Rodrigo Macip, one of my collaborators on this project, look at empty turtle trap in one frame and a large dried up pool in the next. And this is field work that we conducted along the Rio Conchos, particularly around Ojinaga, where historically there were large numbers of kinosternid herdopes. And unfortunately, we found no evidence of herdopes in 4 days of intensive trapping. So that's the end of my introduction. I'm going to hand it over to Jennifer. I'm sorry, I'm going to hand it over to Rodrigo, followed by Jennifer. And then Sam Weaver is going to share with us the results of the genetic analysis and also niche modeling that he did. And then we'll loop back around for sort of a roundtable open discussion about the overall results of our work and what some next steps may be.
This project concerns to the Mexican part of the rock-footed mud turtle. So I want to give you a very short introduction about conservation of Mexican turtles. Turtle diversity in Mexico is really high. Mexico is the second richest country with more or less 51 recognized turtle species, including marine species or sea turtles, and 14% of all turtles of the world inhabit in Mexico. Pretty close to 67 taxa, including subspecies, are distributed in Mexico. And in this map, world map, you can see the hotspots of turtle diversity, which of course the number one country is the United States, is this part of the Mississippi River and Missouri River basins in the Gulf of Mexico, and other parts of the world like Southeast Asia and the Amazon. But Mexico, together with the US, are a very important hotspot for turtle diversity, at least for non-marine forms. So turtle diversity of Mexico constitutes of 7 families, 14 genera, and 62, maybe 63 taxa. And what is really important is that 37 of these taxa are endemic from Mexico. That means more than 50% of the Mexican turtles are endemic. Here is the taxonomic richness of Mexican turtles divided by family. And we have very threatened families like Dermatemidae and other very diverse families like Kinosternidae, which is the family from the rock footed turtles belongs. And from all the Mexican turtles diversity, 57% are endemic, and there's a lot of several quasi-endemic taxa, like the rock-footed myrtle, which is only in a very tiny part of Texas, but much of its distribution is in Mexico. There's other species with this same pattern, like the Kinosternon arizonense, and in the southern border with Guatemala, we have other species, which is a tiny part in Guatemala, but most of their distribution is in Mexico. This is really interesting because, I mean, Mexico holds a very high turtle diversity. Well, from all the Mexican turtle diversity, 64% of the taxa are protected by Mexican government. In Mexico, the turtle or the species protection is only federal. I mean, by federal government, there's no state protection or other levels of protection in the lower municipalities or government stuff. Only federal government protects Mexican species or Mexican biodiversity. From those total of turtle diversity in Mexico, 60% are included in the red list. But what is interesting is that this red list protection and Mexican protection are not the same species. There's an important discrepancy between this list, and only 26% are on this decides appendices. So it's kind of difficult when we try to protect a Mexican turtle, because there is like probably is under federal protection, but not included in the red list. So that limits the amount of funding for protected species. Well, the red-footed myrtle, which Andy told us is there's six subspecies inside, is mainly distributed in this part in central, in between the two sierras in Mexico, and not just a tiny part in Texas. And in this fig, in this map, in the left, down left corner, there's a red circle which indicates the subspecies of Kinosternon irtipes megacephalum, which is already extinct. And in the left, in the right, sorry, the right map, there is a distribution of the other taxa, which is Kinosternon chapalense in like pink, Kinosternon magdalense in one of the red circles in orange, and Kinosternon tarasense in green in the other red figure. And in the east part of the distribution is Kinosternon irtipes, which is Mexico City Valley. This part is Mexico City, which means that this turtle is in one of the highest populated cities in the world. And for Mexico government is under special protection, which is kind of the protection for the endemic species, and for the red list is at least concerned. Well, this is important because according to Anders Rodin and other people, they account that since 1,500 years, there's a lot of time ago, there is only a few turtles gone extinct in the world. And most of those turtles are from small archipelagos like the Galapagos, the Seychelles, and the which is near the Aldabra in the Indian Ocean, and one of the subspecies of Mexican rock-footed myrtle. I mean, this is really important because this is one of the extinct turtles in the last 500 years, and this is not an island turtle. Well, here is part of our data from the last 3 years, at least, from surveys in central Mexico, which has been moving around surveying for rock-footed myrtle in Pátzcuaro Lake, which is the first line, and in Zapotlán Lake, which is in Jalisco, and in the Magdalena Valley, which is in near Michoacán, I mean between Michoacán and Jalisco, and the Valley of Mexico. And those highlighted in yellow are the rock footed material data we gathered for this, with this sample before, which are night traps and night trap hours. And we found very few rock footed murterals. Like for example, in Pátzcuaro, we found only 25, but in Chapala, we find none, zero turtles. But instead in Chapala Lake, which is supposed to be Kinosternon irtipis chapalense, we find 103 Kinosternon integrum, which is supposed to be native, but it's kind of a discussion if it's native or not from Chapala Lake. And those 103 individuals, we collected in 2 days. And in Zapotlan Lake, we found only 4 Kinosternon irtipis chapalenses and also very few from Kinosternon integrum. And the Magdalena Valley, we found 6 rock-footed murterals and 67 Kinosternon integrum, which is very abundant. And in Mexico City Valley, we found 2 rock-footed murterals, but not the endemic subspecies, which is Kinosternon irtipis, but the Kinosternon irtipis murragi, which is distributed in Michoacán, and it's supposed to be distributed until Texas. And we also found Kinosternon integrum in the Valley of Mexico and the red eared slider. So this table is interesting because we found that Kinosternon integrum is moving, or at least distributed, in the same sites and in the same habitats than the rock-footed murterals supposed to be. And the Kinosternon integrum, or the Mexican murterals, is known for a very competitive and a murteral with a very high numbers in their populations. So with this data, another complementary data from the literature, another research in Central Mexico, we conducted a population viability analysis on the rock-footed murteral, at least on the from Michoacán, which is Kinosternon irtipis murragi, and we run 3 scenarios, and only with the optimistic scenario, we just get a slow extinction probability and a final stand individuals of more than 200 individuals. We use several parameters, and what is interesting from this analysis is you can play with the data, adding harvest, limiting harvest, and other threats to the species. And apparently, I mean, if we only conserve habitat and leave the turtles alone without harvest, these turtles can go well, at least in this simulated exercise. And sorry. Well, what about, I want to give a very short background for what this Sam is going to talk you in the next slides, is how are the phylogenetically related or relationship about the subspecies of Kinosternon irtipis? Well, in 1981, Professor Iverson proposed this hypothesis based on only morphological characters using parsimony. And this is the only evidence of these phylogenetical relationships. And most of the relations are based on the how close they are geographically. And there's a huge dichotomy, a huge polygamy in 4 taxas. Then Professor Iverson and his colleagues in 2013, they published this phylogeny of all the Kinosternids with 6 genes. And they only give information about the species as a whole, not the subspecies, and put the Kinosternon irtipis as a sister taxa of Kinosternon chimalhuaca, and then with Kinosternon sonoriense, who previously has been considered as the sister taxa. And this will be important in the next slides. And In 2014, Phil Spence and his collaborators and colleagues, they published an updated phylogeny of the kinosternids, and they provide only three samples of kinostern UTPs, but they did not define from which population of region came, and also it is kind of difficult to understand from their phylogeny if Kinosternon eutypes is a sister taxon of Chimalhuaca or Sonoriense and Integum. So we propose a different approach with more data and based on next generation sequencing with a lot of molecular data that Sam will told you about it. And we basically found a very different, not so different than Iverson's, but very different phylogenetic relationships between Kinosternon UTPs with their sister taxa. And we want to talk to you later about how this new lineage among the Kinosternon UTPs we are proposing. And that's will be all from my part. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. This is Dr. Jennifer Smith from New Mexico State University in Alamogordo, and I'm providing a brief overview of the history of the rough-footed mud turtle found in far west Texas in Presidio County. This turtle was the subject of my dissertation, which began in 2011. I'd like to acknowledge our conservation partners that include the Texas Parks and Wildlife Conservation License Plate Grant, Texas Parks and Wildlife Department, Texas Department of Transportation, New Mexico State University, University of Texas at Austin, University of California at Los Angeles, Wildlife Conservation Society, and the San Antonio Zoo, and hopefully the El Paso Zoo for our future captive breeding program. So there's a lot of common names for this species, and we'll stick with the scientific name here, which is Kinosternum hirtipes murrayi. And in Latin, hirtus means hairy or rough, and pes means foot. Thus, the species was given the name of hirtipes because of the characteristic patches of papilloskin on the inner hind legs of both males and females. Their tails are also covered with these little bumps, and is the easiest way to differentiate quickly in the field between its congener, K. flavescens, or the yellow mud turtle. Turn them over and look at their tails. If it's smooth, it's probably a yellow, and if it's bumpy, it's probably one of ours that is a lot less common. So other identifying features, if you get more into it, is the carapace is dark olive green and sometimes more flat and other times more domed. And I've found that it's depending on the location of the population. But generally the carapace is at least slightly domed on the posterior end and slowly slopes towards the anterior end. The plastron is often lighter with brown in the areas of recent growth. Sometimes you can age the juveniles on these growth rings if they're not too old and worn. Travis LeDuc from UT Austin showed me how to do this in the field, so thank you, Travis. And lastly, there's two pairs of fleshy barbels on the chin of both male and female, and this is specific to K. hirtipes murrayi. In 1986, a paper was written by Dr. Jim Scuddy, who at the time was a professor at Sorrel State University in Alpine, Texas, and Denny Miller, who was head of the Chihuahuan Desert Research Institute, both of whom I was fortunate enough to study under. Denny showed me the ropes to carry on his and Dr. Scuddy's work, so thank you, Denny. We're working hard to preserve this species in Texas. This paper described the historic locations, which included the type locality, where it was first described by Glass and Hartwig in 1951, and named the subspecies murrayi after the respective professor. Fred Gilbach from Baylor University found only two populations in 1971 in Texas, one of which was also this type locality location. This is how the turtles got the nickname, said with a smile by local ranchers, as the Baptist turtles. The other location found by Gilbach was 16 miles south of this location. Based on Gilbach's report, the turtles were placed on the Texas Protected Non-Game Species List in 1977. That was published by Conant and Berry in 1978. During my work on searching for populations of turtles, I've found that all of these historic locations, with the exception of the type locality, had either been drained by landowners due to their dislike of cattails or due to drought conditions. In addition, my research crew and I searched the entire drainage basin of Alameda Creek all the way south to the Rio Grande confluence, where we did not find turtles. They were known historically to be in the Rio Grande. However, the good news is that some new locations have been found that have evolved over the last 20 years or so. And this was the best I could determine based on Miller and Scuddy's publication, Global Images and Memories of Those Who've Been Around in the Area. These relatively new locations are all fed by artesian springs, with 3 out of 4 being man-made ponds or tanks, and the other is located in a running creek, which probably most closely mimics their native habitat. 1 out of 3 of these populations is thriving, with juveniles showing up each year, and this complex is what my data reflect that I will discuss later. The rest of these populations have an issue or two. One problem is at the top locality, where there were very few turtles and no females, no juveniles. We caught the record-sized male turtle at this location with a carapace length of 195 millimeters, which makes sense because this location has been around the longest, so it's natural that the turtles are large. There were very few turtles at this location, and I never caught a female or a juvenile. Therefore, this population is not increasing and is probably not sustainable. A second population that is having issues because there are huge catfish in the pond. I haven't caught any juveniles at this location either. I believe the juveniles are either being eaten, predated on their way to the pond, or if they make it to the pond, they're being consumed by the catfish. There are both males and females in this pond, and they are all large size adults of 125 millimeter carapace length and larger. The third population was found to have an infestation of a sessile-stalked rotifer in the genus Epistylus. We removed the 7 turtles from this pond, dried it out, rehabilitated the pond for a healthier water quality, and treated the turtles at the San Antonio Zoo. Hopefully, they will be returned sometime this year to their new and healthy home. It's important to note that there were no juveniles at this location either, probably due to the deteriorated health of the adults. I only have about 1.5 minutes left. I could talk all day about these turtles, but luckily for you, time is limited. So I calculated the population using mark and recapture in the Jolly-Seaver method for the locations over 3 years. This estimate's not been updated since 2016, and I calculated the population to be at 165 individuals. This was at the currently known locations at the time. Since then, we have found a few more locations, but one of those has no juveniles due to predation of the catfish, and the other we know to be at 7 individuals because that pond we drained and treated for the infestation. When doing my field work, I would find desiccated carapaces around the ponds, and some weren't that near the ponds, maybe about 100 yards away. There were at least 12 incidences that I found them. They were found with canine-like bite marks, and some were cracked completely open, breaking the carapace. Others were just emptied out of all tissue with the carapace left intact. We published a study on this in 2018 with Platt Smith, Rainwater, and Boeing. When doing the telemetry study, I actually tracked a female that I believe left the pond overnight to nest and had been eaten. So when I found her the next morning, she was still wet. And I believe she was eaten by a raccoon because of how clean the inside of the carapace was, and there was no canine bite marks and no cracks. Turtles are vulnerable to predation when exposed by low water levels in ponds and when making overland movements between ponds and during nesting. I am out of time, so I will pass this over so we can hear from our other team members.
So like Andy said, I was really lucky to get kind of roped into this project. I actually have never physically encountered any of these turtles, but getting to work with their genetics was a real treat, and it's still ongoing, and it's still a treat. But the main goals of the genetic portion of this project were to assess the population structure across the entire range of kind of certain herdapes to figure out where clusters of genetic variation line up along the landscape. Secondly, we wanted to identify evolutionary distinct lineages within the K herpes complex. And finally, to assess levels of genetic diversity across the range to maybe identify any populations that were suffering inbreeding or reduced diversity. And then finally, assessing the availability of suitable habitat now and in the future for these turtles. So we'll start by investigating the population structure. So like I just said, we want to see where the major clusters are within Chinocernans as a whole, and especially within Chinocernan herpes, and then trying to figure out if the subspecies designations line up with previous descriptions of the subspecies based on phenotypic and geographic evidence. And we used quite a few different approaches to look at the genetics of these species. We did a principal components analysis, a neighbor joining dendrogram. We used admixture, which is a program that basically identifies different clusters of populations. And then finally, we constructed a phylogeny using a maximum likelihood approach. And the first thing we're going to look at is a principal components analysis. Basically, we give it all of our genetic data, the genetic variation, and we try to identify major axes that can describe the variation that we're seeing in the genomes. And what we're looking at here, all these points represent one individual. And then the different colors are the different either species or subspecies, so the different taxa that we have. And so the first cluster up here is kind of Chinocernan chimawaka, which we kind of discussed earlier, one of the outgroups of this species. And then we also have another two closely related kind of sternid species. So same genus, different species in Oaxaca and Integrum. And this is kind of interesting because they don't seem to cluster apart from one another in genetic space. And then down here, we have kind of sternid sonoriense, which we think is the sister taxa. And then now this cluster here, all these different colors are the different transvolcanic belt subspecies. So those are Chinocernan tarasense, Chinocernan herpes, Chinocernan chapaliense, and Chinocernan magdalense. And you can actually see that tarasense is completely contained within herpes, but not a lot of differentiation here. But there is another cluster, which actually is kind of hidden because it's in yellow, unfortunately, but Chinocernan murrayi are all of these points out here. So from a genetics perspective, it seems like there's more differentiation between Chinocernan herpes murrayi, a subspecies, and those transvolcanic belt subspecies than there is between even two recognized species in Oaxaca and Integrum, which is kind of interesting. And this is another approach which basically looks at genetics and tries to identify major clusters of variation, but it also kind of tells us who's most closely related to who, or who has the most, you know, similar allele frequencies. Once again, Chimalhuaca kind of comes out as this big outgroup. And then we have another cluster of Integrum and Hake. We have kind of Chinocernan sonoriense down here in these black dots. Then we have three actually kind of Chinocernan these murrayi clusters. This is a sample from Durango, Mexico. And then we also have the transvolcanic belt subspecies clustering together once again. So I should move this out. So yeah, kind of that same clustering pattern where we seem to have kind of Chinocernan herpes murrayi pretty distantly related to, or pretty well separated and distinct from the other subspecies in the transvolcanic belt. And this is going to look very confusing at first, but basically each bar here going vertically is one individual. And the color of that bar indicates a population that it was assigned to. So this is what we call an admixture graph. Basically, we say we want to identify seven different genetic clusters. And so it says, okay, we want to make seven clusters that are all closely related to each other. And so it goes and sorts individuals into these different populations. And some of them can have, you know, a genetic background from multiple species here. So this is kind of an admixed individual. Maybe some genetic material from both species. And so the first two groups that come out, once again, are Chimalhuaca, and then in this light blue, and then Oaxaca and Integrum in pink. So once again, our two outgroup species. In red is Sonoriense, so once again, clearly distinct from everything else. And here, actually, we have two different populations of murrayi coming out. And then we have our last two populations. So which are Magdalense and Chapaleense together, and then Herdopes and Tarasense together. So those are the other big clusters. So once again, there's definitely some significant population structure looking across, and it seems to line up with whether in the transvolcanic belt or not. And then even within that transvolcanic belt, we're seeing some clear differentiation between different basins. And so we did make a phylogeny for all these samples, as Rodrigo kind of pointed out. And once again, Integrum and Oaxaca are kind of the outgroup. Chimalhuaca isn't pictured here, but that was a pretty distant ancestor to all of them. And then this big white gap here, which is going to be revealed any second now, we're kind of working our way through, is going to be all the Herdopes samples, but we have really well-supported Sonoriense as the sister taxa to all of our kind of sternin Herdopes. And so finally, this is where all of them fall out. And then if we're going to think about the current subspecies designations, all of our Murrayi samples form a nice clade out here. Once again, pretty distantly related to the others. And once again, the depth of this split is comparable to the depth of the split between two recognized species in Oaxaca and Integrum. So pretty important to note that. But then even within the transvolcanic belt species, we still have some really well-supported nodes that indicate unique evolutionary histories. So the first of which is Chapaleense, so that subspecies that we talked about from Lake Chapala and a few other basins nearby. They form the most ancestral unique lineage here. Magdalense also forms its own unique lineage. And then if we're going to keep thinking about those subspecies with really, really small ranges, Tarasense is the third of those, if you're excluding the extinct Megacephalum. But Tarasense does not form its own, it's not well supported as its own node. And furthermore, it's not monophyletic. It's contained within all of our kind of sternin Herdopes samples. So if we were to look at this phylogeny and the genetic relationships according to the old taxonomy, we would have to split kind of sternin Herdopes into two different clusters, give Tarasense its own cluster, and then we have yet another sample from Mexico City, actually, out here from kind of sternin Herdopes. So based on this and all of the results from the other structural analyses, we can kind of infer that Tarasense is not a meaningful group evolutionarily and genetically. So we would propose to cluster that within Herdopes. And so now thinking about how we might move forward classifying these different taxa, there could definitely be an argument for elevating some of these subspecies to full species status. And if you were to try and do that while also preserving the real evolutionary relationships between them, this is kind of what you would propose. And thinking about the geography of these different subspecies looks something like this. So we have Murrayi to the north, and these are only the samples that we had for our genetic study. So we have a lot of other occurrence records that we'll talk about later, but these were the ones included in the genetics, the sequencing. We have Herdopes, Chapaleense, and Magdalense across the transvolcanic belt. And so this is kind of what we're proposing moving forward for subspecies or even full species designations. And then finally, another way to think about genetic diversity and divergence between them is through a heat map. Basically, each one of these cells is the comparison between two individuals where we say, we compared this many sites across your DNA, and there were this many differences. So the more differences you have per site, the redder the cell is going to be. So for example, these are all of the Murrayi individuals going here, and you can see that once they start hitting the Herdopes, you see a lot of divergence between our Murrayi samples and the transvolcanic belt samples. That's what this whole thing is. So clearly very different. And then another way of thinking about it is within species too. We want to think about diversity within these species because you need genetic diversity if you want to adapt, if you want to maintain healthy populations. And so the lighter colors within a species mean they have less diversity within that species. And you can also visualize substructure this way. So if you remember way back when we've been talking about two different clusters within Murrayi, we can see that here too. So we can see a little bit more differentiation between some Murrayi samples than others. So there's probably two different clusters, and this kind of lines up with the samples from Texas, actually, and then the samples from Durango and Chihuahua. And then thinking about the diversity within all of our other subspecies, that's kind of what these other squares represent. They seem to have much higher values of genetic diversity and heterozygosity within their own species. So Murrayi seems to be the most at risk in terms of lacking genetic diversity. And so we decided to look at inbreeding within all of these populations to try and figure out which populations might be the most inbred. This can result in a number of problems. You can have the accumulation of harmful recessive alleles. So inbreeding is really not great for the long-term viability of populations. And so when we look at our northern populations again, these darker red colors mean that it's a higher level of inbreeding. And you can see that those northern populations in Texas and Chihuahua, and even in Durango, Murrayi is suffering much higher levels of inbreeding than those transvolcanic belt subspecies. So for whatever reason, they seem to be very inbred, and that could be maybe due to isolation between different populations. There might not be as much opportunity for them to mate with individuals for migration between different basins, but inbreeding could definitely be a problem for Pandastern and Herdopes murrayi. So to summarize that all up, basically Murrayi, Magdalense, and Chapaleense, and the nominate subspecies, Pandastern and Herdopes, form well-supported evolutionarily distinct lineages. And the divergence between Murrayi and Herdopes is as ancient as the divergence between some well-recognized species. And so we propose the recognition of essentially, potentially three new species in Murrayi, Magdalense, and Chapaleense based on this genetic evidence. And Tarasense is nested within Herdopes and should be included as a part of that. But we also wanted to look at patterns of ecological differentiation between these subspecies. We know about geographic variation. We know that they're isolated from one another, but we want to know how different the environments they live in are. And we also want to figure out how that's going to change in the future. But basically, we use MaxScent, which is a really common program to generate niche models and species distribution models for each of these proposed taxa. So we used occurrence records obtained from previous studies by Rodrigo and countless other people. We have had to exclude Magdalense from any of these modeling efforts because after you filter for unique captures, as well as keeping sites that are 50 kilometers apart, we filtered out pretty much all of the Magdalense records except for two. And you really can't make any meaningful predictions about habitat when you only have two known occurrence records for a species. So they sadly didn't make the cut here. We have some and basically this is the distribution for the species that we have. So basically what we do is we take some environmental data here, temperature seasonality, which is just how much it varies from month to month. And we overlay that on occurrence records to try and figure out how we can use environmental data to predict where a species might occur. And when we do that, we get an idea of which environmental variables are most important in determining where these turtles can actually live. And it turns out temperature seasonality is the most important variable for every single subspecies that we looked at. And it's pretty important for differentiating between them. But then also, there are a few things that differ between each of our species. So for example, here, within these boxes, in Murrayi, which is on our far left here, you can see that the variables associated with precipitation seasonality, so precipitation during the coolest quarter and the driest quarter, are really important for determining where Pandastern and Murrayi can be found, but not so much for Chapaleense or Herdopes. So while temperature seasonality is really important for all of them, some things are unique across them. And so if we wanted to, once again, do a principal component analysis to try and find just major axes of variation, just how different are the environments they live in, this is looking at three different dimensions that explains more of the variation. We can see that all of our Murrayi samples are kind of out here, away from those transvolcanic belt subspecies. So once again, Herdopes and Chapaleense look to occupy a pretty similar niche, and it's a little easier actually to visualize within two dimensions. So here we've drawn ovals around each subspecies. And you can see that both Chapaleense and Magdalense are actually contained within the niche space of Kynasternin hertipes. But Kynasternin murrayi does seem to be pretty distinct. There is a small amount of overlap, but for the most part, pretty well differentiated. And along this axis, it's mostly things that are associated with the seasonality of precipitation, like I kind of pointed out before. I want to think about looking at, like, really trying to figure out how different they are. This is a good way of thinking about it. So this shows the average temperature seasonality across the occurrence records for each species. And we can see that there's a lot more variable temperature for murrayi relative to the subspecies that are in the transvolcanic belt. So this is one of the major things that sets murrayi apart. They can tolerate a lot more seasonality and temperature potentially than the other subspecies. And then this is kind of looking at measures of niche overlap, just to actually try and quantify whether or not their niches are the same or not. And if we use our best fitting model, which is maybe a little overfit, we can see that there is a significant lack of overlap between murrayi and the other two transvolcanic belt subspecies, which is pretty interesting. So they do not occupy the same environmental niche, well differentiated. But then if we use a more generalized model, you can only see kind of a moderate amount of differentiation, not the same degree that we see with the best fitting models, but still differentiation between murrayi and Chapaleense, and then a little bit more overlap between murrayi and hertipes. And there's really no overlap, or there's a lot of overlap between Chapaleense and hertipes in terms of their environmental niche. So they basically occupy the same ecological conditions. And so now that we have an idea of these relationships, we want to think about where the suitable habitat is now and where it's going to be in the future. Because if we're going to put effort into, for example, making breeding programs for these turtles, we want to know there's going to be good environmental conditions for them to persist in the future. And also to try and get an idea of how threatened these turtles really are. And so that's what we did. So these are species distribution models that show the habitat suitability. And we're going to do this for each subspecies. So for murrayi, you can see this is the current distribution. And you can see that there's quite a bit of suitable habitat, which is mostly around where we know they occur. And then if we want to think about applying this to the future, this GIF kind of shows the, but how it's going to change. So as you go through time, this is projections for 2020, 2050, and 2070. And what's interesting about this is actually, so green means good habitat. And you can see that as you progress into the future, the habitat suitability for Kynasternin murrayi is actually like a really positive outlook. They seem to be gaining quite a bit of suitable habitat across their current range. That's such a rosy story for the other two subspecies in the transvolcanic belt. So hertipes, once again, pretty widely distributed here. This shows the suitable habitat currently in 2020. And then if you want to project that into the future, as time progresses, we see a huge decrease in the amount of available habitat for this subspecies especially. If we were basically to continue on our current trajectory in terms of emissions, they will only have about 1.6% of their suitable habitat remaining across the range by 2070, which is obviously not ideal. And then finally, for Chapaleense, once again, this is a far more restricted species geographically in terms of where we know they occur. And so we generated that. And looking forward in time, once again, it doesn't look great. It's not as dire as hertipes, but still like a 50% reduction. And we actually quantified here in this table where you can see that murrayi is going to see this, you know, big increase in available habitat, but depending on your scenario, and there's obviously more uncertainty as you get into 2070 when you're making these projections of climate. But no matter how you slice it, those transvolcanic belt subspecies are in danger of losing a lot of their habitat. So like I said, murrayi is pretty good. Those other two subspecies, it doesn't look great. So to summarize all of that up, there does appear to be pretty good differentiation in terms of ecological niche space between the northern Kynasternin murrayi and the southern subspecies, or potential species, if you want to think about it that way. in those transvolcanic belt subspecies appear to show little, if any, divergence in ecological niche space. So while they are genetically distinct, they do occupy pretty much the same environmental conditions. And then finally, those transvolcanic belt subspecies are faced with large amounts of reduction in habitat. So just to summarize those recommended taxonomic revisions, potentially raise those subspecies, Murrayi, Magdalense, and Chapaleense, to full species status, and then absorb Tarasense into the nominant Kynosternin herdopes. And if you are kind of worried maybe about this, Kynosternin murrayi definitely has the strongest case since it is so clearly differentiated genetically, and there's a lot more divergence there, and it's also differentiated ecologically. So geographically, ecologically, any way you want to, genetically, any way you want to cut it, Kynosternin murrayi appears to be very different from herdopes, which could change how we think about conserving them. Andy mentioned earlier that they're not on the red list currently because they have this wide distribution. But since they do appear to be their own evolutionary unit, numbers are probably way off. And they're probably a much higher conservation concern than we have typically thought of them as, if we think of them as one large collective, as opposed to their own new subspecies or species. And those other two species have a fairly good case genetically, but not as strong. And if you want to think about how we can improve the genetic diversity in those northern populations, right, in Texas, we just kind of talked about how inbred they are and the lack of genetic diversity overall. Actually, if you look at the population comparison just between Texas and Chihuahua, you can see that there's a lot of differentiation, but a lot of those are fixed sites. So they've lost a lot of the genetic diversity as a result of inbreeding, but they seem to occupy pretty similar environmental niches. And if you were to maybe introduce one to the other, you could restore a lot of heterozygosity and a lot of genetic diversity simply by introducing new turtles from another population, which could help prevent a lot of future issues down the road for the long-term viability of these species. Another thing that we really need more of is to try and increase the sampling of these individuals to get a better picture of the genetics. So we do have some pretty big gaps between our current known occurrences for the genetic studies. So if we can include more of those basins, we can get a better idea of exactly how isolation by distance is working here. Like really, how isolated are these populations, the different basins? Is that what's causing the inbreeding, or is it something else? We can also identify some more key landscape features that can help us figure out what the important barriers are to gene flow between each of these lineages, and then even between individual populations. And then phenotypic studies based on these new identified groupings will be useful because the old phenotypic designations clearly don't reflect the evolutionary relationships. So like pretty much all of the genetic kind of Kynosternin herdopes were designated as Kynosternin herdopes murrayi. So the genetics definitely don't reflect the old phenotypic classifications across this group, save for Chapaleense and Magdalense. So those also need to be revisited to reflect the evolutionary relationships between these turtles. And with that, I have nothing left to say. So feel free to take control back.
Thank you, Sam.
I just wanted to provide a really brief summary at the end of that. So, you know, I think Sam really made a compelling presentation that one, there's a lot of hidden diversity within Kynosternin herdopes, specifically those populations assigned to the subspecies murrayi represent a separate, deeply divergent lineage, and that those populations are currently suffering from very low genetic diversity, isolation, and encouragingly, it's the first good news I've heard about climate change. It looks like by 2070, there may be quite a bit more habitat for this organism, which taking all of those factors into consideration, it seems that as far as conservation actions that can and should be done, number one is we need to formally publish the results of this work and revise the taxonomic status of this, which will then break free, hopefully, greater attention on the part of U.S. and Mexican governments, and hopefully will make available more funding to work on the conservation of these species. The steps that he described in terms of potentially crossing individuals from these two subgroups within Murrayi to increase their jack diversity and resiliency, that's a really good investment, because if we can get those turtles through for the next 50 to 70 years and not let them blink out due to the conditions that they're suffering now, there's every chance that that taxon is going to have a much rosier future. So those investments that would be made in preserving and promoting and increasing jack diversity in Murrayi, you know, you're not pumping the chest of a dying patient here. We just need to get them through the next half century, and potentially they'll have a much rosier future. So that's my argument for do something now.
Thanks, Andy, for that. Looks like we're pretty much out of time for the main part of the presentation. We do have a couple of questions, though, in the Q&A section. Let me just figure this out real quick. I'm not sure which one of you this is best addressed to, but feel free to jump in, whoever it is. How does this habitat assessment mesh with human demands for water into the future?
I know Jen definitely has some experience with this, but so this was more on kind of a macro climate scale, this habitat assessment that we have now. But as Jen pointed out earlier when she was talking, the microhabitat is incredibly important for these species, the quality of the individual pools, and actually making sure that they can stay around is clearly very important, because if we lose that, then we lose the populations, regardless of whether or not the broader climate conditions are there for them to survive. And with population expansion, I know specifically in Texas, this is a pretty big issue. But increased water demand will probably lead to the depletion of a lot of maybe ephemeral streams, which these turtles count on. So while the bigger climate might support populations, that's going to be really important. And Jen, you might, or Rodrigo or Andy, you guys all might have better ideas specifically about how it might impact things locally.
I do have that concern because, can y'all hear me? Okay, I do have that concern because it's so vast out there, and all the ponds are fed by an artesian spring, which is, of course, groundwater, and they're starting to develop it down that highway where they're all located, and they're subdividing like crazy. Every time I go out there, I see new survey tapes, so that is definitely a concern, because if we use up the groundwater, then they're gone.
Okay, thanks, Jen. There's a follow-up question. Is what would potential habitat expansion look like with climate change?
I want to put them wherever we can get them. Go north, New Mexico. I mean, they do, if they're going to do well, then we can expand them if we can get some juveniles with a captive breeding program. That's my two cents.
You're talking about assisted colonization here. There's probably not much opportunity for natural colonization.
No. Yeah, if you look at how isolated the currently occupied spots are, and Sam's model, I think it was that map was based on habitat within 100 kilometers or 50 kilometers of existing populations. That's going to be rough for turtles, especially turtle populations that are on the brink right now. And so we should anticipate that, you know, if we were going to try and take advantage of an increase in suitable habitat, that's going to involve human help.
Yeah, that makes sense. And obviously, that I presume that region is the rainfall. Things are expected to dry out, right? They're not expected to get wetter. So it's more of it's more about temperature changes than precipitation per se.
Temperature seasonality is a really important part for determining where they can live. Yep, and yeah, those northern populations seem to tolerate it much better than the species in central Mexico. So Murray, in theory, should be able to do fine with, you know, maybe less fluctuation in temperature, although there is a pretty high association with variation in seasonal precipitation. So like precipitation during the warmest quarter, wettest quarter. And I don't know specifically how those are going to change. And like I said, there's quite a bit of variance when you're looking all the way into 2070 on where things could go. But at least from the broader climate perspective, it looks like they should be okay. And I also did limit that analysis to their current range because, like Andy said, turtles don't move very far. And trying to account for maybe some populations that haven't been found yet, just trying to identify, you know, other potential areas where we could currently find turtles and other current areas where they could be. But yeah, in the future, like I said, I didn't show the full projections, but the projected suitable habitat in the future does extend pretty far outside of the current range. So there could be a lot of opportunities for human-assisted migration, but I don't know what type of issues that could pose with microhabitats and potentially even exposure to novel pathogens and things like that. So.
That's great. So one last question before we wrap it up. Are you going to formally propose the taxonomic revisions in the publication from this work? Is that basically next on the list?
Hell yeah.
Okay. Fantastic. Well, that's great. Well, I appreciate all the questions, everybody. We're obviously a little bit over time. I just wanted to thank all the speakers. This was great, super informative. We, you know, this was only a small grant, and you guys really knocked it out of the park. We really appreciate all of the work here. Fantastic. And if there are any other additional questions, you know, and you want to get in touch with any of the speakers, please reach out to me or Meredith, and we can connect everybody. Okay. Just a final plug for the next webinar up in a couple of weeks. We've got winter bat roost in Texas. Stay tuned. This will be archived and up on our webpage and on our YouTube channel at some point in the next, you know, 2-3 weeks or so. So if anybody wants to revisit it, please do. So thanks again for your time. Thanks again to the speakers, and we'll catch you guys soon.